Well, I feel like our little corner is home. When we come into the village of Champlain, if this isn't home, our little corner doesn't have one. What a wonderful day in a great community, fairly early in the month of June, as we prepare for a major celebration. We're standing, Mary Ann Kerr and myself, in front of the sign for Paquette Park. We realize that this park has been here since 1973, celebrating Larry Paquette and his dad, right, Mary Ann?
Correct, yes, and his father.
And isn't that wonderful? A nice little park. Calvin was telling me about standing over in a building that was Ma somebody's across the road, Ma Doopy's place, and watching the fire in the middle of the winter and pictures of the icicles. And the face of Champlain has changed a little over the years, but there are still a lot of wonderful landmarks. I should say, first of all, Mary Ann, for those of our viewers who, I don't know how many, there could be maybe one or one and a half, who don't know who you are, you've been an employee of the post office here for a long time.
This post office, 25 years, yeah.
This, you mean you worked for another one?
No, I didn't, but I've only been to this one 25 years.
25 years, yeah. That's, I guess you might stick it out then, huh?
A few more years.
We talk about the face of Champlain changing. It's a wonderful community. It's a neighborly place.
Yeah,
I've said that so many times. And we don't always have to have an ice storm to get the neighbors together.
No, but when I first came here, I didn't know a soul. That was maybe 26 years ago, 27. And I had people bring me food, and I didn't know a soul. And we came during an ice storm, believe it or not. And
my neighbors
across the street just came in and said, don't cook dinner, we'll have it for you, just tell me what time you want it here, and we moved in.
You know, there are people, I wish we could show this in some of the major metropolitan areas around the globe, because people don't believe communities like this exist anymore.
Well, my mom didn't believe it when, you know, this night, it was Rita Barrier, they lived across the street from us, and she brought everything, even the dishes, and then she took everything home and washed them, and we were fine, and the next morning she came over again.
Oh, that's the what
really
neat
great
memories.
Yeah,
no wonder
nice.
This place ingratiated itself to you the first day. Where did you come from?
Originally, I'm from Long Island.
Where?
Franklin Square.
Oh, see, now we got to get back to the nitty-gritty here. Franklin Square.
Yeah.
You were born and brought up there?
I was born in Manhattan, raised on Long Island, came to Plattsburgh State, and met my husband.
Isn't that, what a great
never
story.
Left.
Never left.
For a brief while we left, while Cliff was in the Navy, but then we came back.
Unfortunately, Champlain has worn the edges off that wonderful New York City area accent.
Really? Not, everyone doesn't say that. I agree with you.
Well,
but
I lived on the island for a long time and graduated from Stony Brook in its first graduating class, and I knew a lot of people and still correspond with them, and they have their accents are way better than yours. So Champlain has had really an overall effect on you,
yeah,
and just
probably
wearing the edges down off that great accent.
Yeah. I think the North Country has I have a little accent left, I believe.
Yeah, just a little
a tad,
bit. May you never lose it. Where do you live? Nearby here?
I live up on Oak Street.
Okay, now
that away. Right up that street.
All right. Yeah. This is a nice, decent little park that people maintain. It's had its ups and downs over the years, but it looks pretty decent today.
Well, this is new. This is only a year old that you're looking at. This was an empty lot a year ago with only a flagpole. And the beautification committee applied for a state grant 2 years ago, and we were allotted $10,000 to dedicate the park, rededicate it to the Paquettes and make it a place where people could come down in the evening and sit, and the river is gorgeous here, and so this is the first stage of it. We have many more things that we want to do to the village, but this was the place that we started.
It's great. We'll invite any viewers who may not be from this immediate area to come down and sample the community, starting right here at Paquette Park. Let's talk a little bit about this beautification committee and how you got involved with it.
It was about 4 years ago. I initially thought that the town had so many pretty buildings, and I thought that maybe if we had a committee, no matter how small it would be a start to get people having pride in their village. So I went to the village board and asked them if they would sanction another committee, And we got some people together, and I can tell you on the board right now, there's Florence Cardan, Nancy LeClaire, Cecile Filion, Gloria Graham, and myself. And we've had other members like Lisa Cardan, who has moved from here and gone to Rouse's Point. Our liaison between the village committee and us is Kim Tremblay. She attends all of our meetings. And we're just trying our best to be the eyes of the community. And as we walk or as we see things that are wrong, we tell them. They don't like us sometimes when we come in and tell them that, you know, maybe a sidewalk is heaving or something like that. But we do tell them so that we help out.
I wonder how many communities this size have a beautification committee.
I don't know. I have no idea of any.
This seemed like a good idea at the time.
It did, because we have a small public works, and they are so overburdened with everything that they do that we just took it upon ourselves to do it. And we hope that this park will give people pride in the community, and maybe we can start fixing up the facades and painting and doing other things to welcome more people to come and live here.
You know, it's amazing. They started a downtown project some years ago in the city of Plattsburgh, and they did repair and reface a lot of the buildings and facades, and did a great deal down on Durkee Street, and so it looks pretty neat in downtown Plattsburgh.
Well, maybe we can start a little bit here. We just need more community involvement. And we need more monies, too. So.
Well, you know, we've already established the fact that the people get along well in this community, and they like their community, or they wouldn't be living here, and they're an awful lot of long-term residents. And I guess you could consider yourself long-term after 25, 26 years.
Yeah, I think so, too.
So maybe all they need is a little bit of a nudge.
Yeah, well, we hope this park is the little nudge to try to inspire them to do other things. You know, it only takes a few people, and if everyone does a little bit, it can be marvelous, you know.
She's got the pitch, doesn't she? Got it right down pat. Now, this brings us to the real focus, the real reason for our being here today, and that is a pretty special celebration you have coming up.
Yes, it's going to be July 18th of this summer. How it started was when we did the park, we found out that it had been dedicated 25 years ago, and we had a plaque that we found that is on the flagpole over there, and it started from that. We wanted to take the plaque, dust it off, and put it where it belonged, and so we applied for that grant, as I said before. And we did the park. And then we found out that it's also the 125th anniversary of the incorporation of the village. So the ball started to roll. And we wondered what we could do for that day. And we've heard of many towns having so many celebrations, and we've never had anything really. So we thought, what would bring people into town? And one of the things that we started with was the post office was going to do a cancellation. That's always neat.
What does that mean for people who don't know?
Well, for people who don't know it, it's a special design that we had made. And if you bring an envelope with a stamp on it or purchase a stamp from us, we will cancel that stamp with this special cancellation mark. I have an example of it over here.
And, well, we're going to take a look at that and continue our program right after this. We didn't need to take a train or a trolley to this new location. We just moved three steps to the left in front of the flower box. And now we do have a picture of that 125th anniversary cancellation. That's neat.
Isn't that neat looking?
Who did the design?
The design was, we presented Kim from K&G Graphics in Rouse's Point, now located in Champlain. We told her what we needed, the perimeters that you need for a cancellation that's set by the post office, and she did the design, and this, the purple part, is the crest of the village, and we had it taken by Mr. DeLong from Rouse's Point, and we had it blown up, and this, what you're seeing here, is an envelope, And we have purchased these envelopes, and they will be silk screened. They're really going to be nice.
Wow.
They're going to sell for $3 a piece at the celebration.
A bargain at double the price.
A bargain, yeah. They're really quite nice. And the post office will have a kiosk here, I believe, on this side of the tent. And they're going to be selling these, plus they'll be selling stamps for envelopes if you want to just bring your own envelope. We'll also have programs and a booklet made by Celine Parquette, which if you put a stamp on that, we can cancel it with that again. So it's going to be quite nice if people are interested for a piece of history.
It's for people who are interested now and as a bit of a legacy for those people who come along in the next 25 years for the Susquecentennial.
Yeah.
I wonder... Let me see now. You were here in 1973, weren't you?
Mm-hmm.
For the
yes, I
did. They have a 100th anniversary celebration?
Not that much.
I don't remember it. That's the year this community park was dedicated. The plaque mm-hmm. says it on August 25th, I think it is, mm-hmm. 1973. So somebody, they obviously didn't have a committee like yours back then.
No, I don't know what they really did, but we figured it was about time that something would be done for it.
This is such a neat little park. It's not huge, but eventually before we leave this place, we're going to walk over by the riverbank to look down into the river. And, you know, we got a flagpole, we got a beautiful walkway, we got green grass, a few trees that are grown. Some that are on their way to growing, and a nice view of the entire area. So it's a good, like you said, a good spot to come and look around, mm-hmm. reflect.
Well, we hope that eventually we might have something going on in the park, maybe every Wednesday night or once a month during the summer. Maybe you can have a band or somebody or a chamber group.
Straw Hatters right up here,
maybe
boy.
They could do that, but you know, that's to come.
You know, that would be reminiscent of a lot of the great old gazebo days from way back when John Philip Sousa's band would be somewhere playing in the park and ice cream socials. And now you're harking back to my childhood. And yeah, those are great things to do in the nice summertime.
Anybody out there has any ideas? We'll welcome them. We'll welcome new members as well.
Yeah, have you set a cap on how many people you want to be involved with your committee, or?
No, there's no cap.
Can get.
We need new ideas, and I think we need some younger people too, some younger residents to come in and help. There's a lot more that we can do, you know.
Yeah, and how would they get in touch with you, or the president of the committee?
I'm chairperson right now, yeah.
Right.
And get me at the post office or go down to the village office and talk to Joanne or Janice and they'll get me the message.
You'll find them up before they get home.
Grab you right away.
Do you meet on a regular basis with your committee?
We meet once a month. Right now we're meeting more often because there's so many other things that are going on that day that we need to keep on top of it. But once a month we usually meet.
You're going to focus this whole celebration on one day. July 18th.
Mm-hmm. And one thing I'd like to ask anyone that's out there is we're not having much luck with, nor has it been publicized much, but we want to have a village-wide garage sale that day.
That's fun.
And the article should be out in the newspaper soon, but if anyone wants to be a part of the village-wide garage sale, they can contact Doug Agor at 298-8682. And his committee, which is the library fund, is going to, if you want a garage sale, you will be put on a map. They're going to make a map of the village and pinpoint your house and what you're selling and everything. And then people who come to the village will be able to find you on the map. And that's one of the things we're going to have. And also we're looking for vendors who want to be present on the street. Anyone that sells wares, maybe crafts and such, we're going to have the street blocked off for a period of time from 10 till 3 that day.
Oh, great idea.
So we're hoping that that we'll get enough vendors in town to warrant closing the street off for that day.
I bet you if the word gets out, they'll be knocking on your door. Will there be a certain charge depending on how much space they take?
I believe we've decided on $15 for the rental, and it'll be a space that's 20 feet along the street and 10 foot deep on the street. And you can contact Gloria Graham for that. at 298 3027. That's 298 3027. And either of those two numbers will get you anybody. If you can't remember those or have missed what I've said, just call the village offices or get in touch with me.
I'm sure there are thousands of people out there watching this tape or just jotting that number down saying we got to get there that day.
I think the garage sale is going to be, if we can get it into full swing, is going to be really good. It'll draw from all over that day into the village.
Well, you've been here for a quarter of a century. Sounds like a long time when you put it that way. But have you always been interested in the history of this area yourself, or have you really become a student recently?
I guess both. I think more so since we started the committee, because we've really gotten to look into buildings and their history and such. But I've always been interested in the village, yes.
It's fun to get involved with the history, because I've always said it's hard to know where you're going until you know where you've been. When you live in an area, if you're going to become a part of the fabric of it, you have to know what the fabric is.
I think you need to know that, and you need to be a part of the village. Everyone has got to get involved in this village, because if not, it's not going to go anywhere.
Yeah, there are always the doers, and there are always the viewers.
That's true.
You're one of the doers, and if we can turn some of the viewers into doers, you're going to have a wonderful celebration.
Wonderful. I hope so. I really hope
so.
What
have you got down here that you haven't showed me
yet?
I don't think I saw it yet.
No, you haven't. I haven't even spoken to you about it. But
let's talk about it.
Every year since we've had this committee, we try in September to give what we call a Home Pride Award to five people in the village who we feel take pride in their homes and keep up their homes and such. And I just have an example of it, of one of them here that we gave out in 1995 to Cecile and Dick, Cecile and Richard Fillion. And Cecile is now a member of our committee. At this time, she wasn't. But we give it out to people in hopes that, you know, it makes them feel, say, I've done something right, not even knowing it, but my house looks good, and I, you know, I keep up things, and so that's why we give it to them. And they're really shocked when they get it.
And it's a very neat plaque, too.
It's
really quite beautiful. Are those done locally?
This is done by Dot Graphics in Rouse's Point, and the village supplies us with the plaque itself. But in September, we'll be giving out five more.
That's just a great, neat idea. Now, let's talk for just a moment about some things that you're planning for that day besides the community-wide garage sale, flea market.
The flea market and the garage sale. In the morning, there's going to be the rededication of, the dedication of the water treatment plant on River Street. That'll be early morning, I think around 10 or 10:30. We've hired a clown to be here to do magic and such, and we have two face painters coming for children. We hope to do that down in the St. Mary's end, where they can possibly play on the equipment up there. Melissa McManus is going to do a historical walking tour after the dedication. And
she's the mayor, for those people who may not understand that, and we plan to dedicate a part of this program to her explanation and some slides that she has, and that's kind of neat.
I'm trying to think. I think that's about covering it.
That sounds like a pretty full day, and I'm sure you'll think of some more tidbits before July 18th rolls around.
Yeah. Well, I think that's enough. One thing we have to get going is this garage sale and get more people interested in it. But I think it's going to be a good day.
You know, if everybody in this general community shows up on that day, offers their assistance ahead of time, because you'll need a lot of volunteers,
it would be
nice.
It would be great, yeah.
And this, you know, we have a greater community. There are several communities roughly this size in the general area, and they all kind of band together, and I'm sure you wouldn't mind some folks from Rouse's Point and Chazy and West Chazy and Moores.
Anywhere. I think also with the stamp cancellation, I didn't mention it, but that cancellation is put in a nationwide bulletin, And we have a big stamp club in Montreal, so we might see a lot of people from that particular stamp club just coming down for that cancellation.
I don't think it would be a bad idea for the Northern Tier Chamber of Commerce to include that in some of their tourist mailings.
We are on the tourist. We are on a calendar that's being put out by the Tourist Information Bureau for that day, so we are on that for that particular day already.
Because, you know, there are people who travel around and about just to get such cancellations because of their historical value. And there are other people who actually think they might make a buck off things like that someday.
could be.
And what did you say the price was, $3?
For that particular envelope, it's $3 plus the stamp. So it'll be $3.32.
I wonder if Champlain has ever had a special cancellation before.
We did. We had one, but it was in... It was in cooperation with the 200th anniversary of the Postal Service in Champlain. We had that last summer. We had a cancellation. And then the Diversity Committee for the Post Office had a cancellation about 2 years ago. And we had envelopes mail from all over the U.S. for people who read the cancellation date and sent us their plain envelope. And we canceled it and mailed it back to them. So it's something that people don't know that much about stamp cancellations, but if you're into that, it is such a widely done. I didn't know about it until a few years ago, really got into it, but we got letters from all over the nation just for those cancellation marks. So I think this one is going to really work out well, too. And it's a beautiful one this time. So.
Oh, it's absolutely awesome. I can't believe it. Some communities have their cancellations that are famous because they have an odd name, you know, and because of some other reason. But for a celebration of the 125th anniversary, I think that's extra special.
Yeah, I think it is, too. This past weekend in Saratoga, they had a beautiful cancellation for the veterans of all wars. They had a huge parade and a cancellation down there. So it's done more often than you think. But if you're not into stamp collecting, it's nothing that the average John Doe knows about, you know.
Well, I think almost everybody, especially those who live in this area, would love to have a copy of it.
Oh, I think so.
And to buy a few copies to send to their kids who don't live around here and to make their relatives in Oshkosh eat their hearts out because they can't be here for that day. I have a feeling there's going to be a run on those. I hope you have enough.
We have 500, so...
500? Once this program hits the airwaves and our 7 or 8 listeners across the three counties in northern New York get to watch it, our viewers, you might have to get an extra 50 or so print.
Maybe we'll reprint it, but the minimum was 500, so they're quite expensive, so.
I hope it does very well. We're going to move over to the riverbank. I've never gotten that close view over in the riverbank by the fence, so we're going to continue our program over there in just a moment. In answer to your question, no, that is not the Lake Champlain monster, but it's the closest thing we have on this beautiful June day as we stand on the banks of the river up here and look at this beautiful placid river which runs through this community of Champlain. And go back a few months in time when Calvin and I were out doing something out, and Calvin met me and said, I just came from the village and there's a huge tree that's got lodged underneath the bridge. The gas pipe is here. They've closed the bridge. The community is in an uproar. We don't know what's going to happen. Well, ultimately, they did solve the problem. There wasn't any massive explosion, but there you have for everyone to see, and probably for a long time to come, are the remnants of that ice storm and our flooding conditions. What you see here today, Marianne, belies what happens sometimes in the springtime. I wouldn't be surprised if the top of this fence is pretty close to the height of the river at times.
I think it was last year. It was about that high. And we were very upset because the year prior to that it flooded before we did the work. And then after we did the work, we felt that we were safe. And then all of a sudden it came in again, and we were quite pleased that nothing got ruined from what we put in here.
We had a double whammy in 1996 with floods and tremendous ice coming out of the river that made messes on all the North Country rivers. And yes, I've been up here a few times when it was over its banks, but those people who know me know my home is 18 inches from the banks of the Saranac River down in Morrisonville, so I know what can happen. But every night when I sit out there in my enclosed deck and watch the river go by and watch the blue herons fish and watch the other birds, wildlife, and just close my eyes, that makes the whole thing worth it.
Oh, it does. It does. The water is gorgeous, if it's where it's supposed to be.
I can't imagine living too far away from flowing water. That's why people love to take vacations at the ocean, but there's a lot to be said for a nice, placid river like this going through your community. It's decent.
It's decent, and it makes a good setting for the park. I think if people come down here in the evening, they'll really enjoy the river. And now that our trees have, we cut down a lot of trees because of the ice storm, it really gives you even a better view of what we had before.
This is decent. This is a wonderful experience for me to be here. I'd love to just take a look at it. And you know, it's even more fun for me because I've always been a bit of a dreamer and an idealist. I like to stand here and try to imagine what it looked like along this river in 1873. Mm-hmm.
I have no idea, but we do have, if you get the brochure or the booklet that we're having put out, the historical booklet, I believe there's going to be some pictures in there of back 125 years ago. So
that'll be amazing. As you know, early photography was in its heyday, having been started quite a few years before that. And we've talked about a number of famous photographers, including Matthew Brady, who did all the famous Civil War photographs. And Stoddard did many photographs back in that era through the Adirondack region. So you know there had to be a few photographs taken. And that's nice when people bring out the historical stuff on that day, isn't it?
There's a lot out there. When we did the 200th birthday of the post office, we had people from all over give us photographs of what the village looked like back then. It was gorgeous. It was all tree lined. It was very, very pretty. And many more stores than what we have now, maybe 10 times that many. Here, actually, I believe there was, Calvin will refresh my memory, there was a huge block here of stores, a mercantile, and I don't really know what else. Melissa could probably give you that information. But
we'll get that through before we.
All stores.
Before we actually began our program, Calvin was telling me his reminiscences about the fire that we mentioned at the top of this program and what it looked like here. These buildings adjacent to the park, you know, the back end of that building wasn't built in 1996.
No,
that thing is ancient. It's actually sway-backed if you take a look at it. Isn't it amazing?
Yeah, oh, that building? Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, when we excavated for the walkway in the flagpole, there's all the debris is still there underneath the...
All they did was fill them in, plow it in, fill it in.
No.
Well, we were talking about that a while later. This walkway is really quite nice. Who did that?
Northern Blacktopping did that.
It was a considerable expense. You said about $6,000.
$5,600,
yeah. Yeah, because there was a lot of work in digging it out, putting it in, getting it colored, and then putting the pattern on it. It's really quite impressive.
Yeah, street print is the thing that everyone's doing now, but it is expensive. Quite expensive.
Now, obviously, we have grass here. The town comes along, you said, and is it the town that?
Village.
The village that
mows it, yes. And they water the trees.
Now, you mentioned a little while ago that one of these trees, we're not sure which, on either side, is dedicated to the late Bob Venn, who is credited, as everyone knows who watches this program, with starting this whole idea many, many years ago and having done 500 programs with Calvin. He had the bad sense to die on us last year, and so Calvin came to me and we took over the program. But that's kind of neat to have a tree named after you, dedicated in your memory.
Well, when he passed away, we were in the process of doing the park, and his daughter Barbara Maley works at the Government Center, and her colleagues wanted to do something for her in his memory, and they found out about the park, so they called and they collected enough funds to buy one tree and one bench.
Oh, isn't that
so
great?
So that the bench isn't by the tree, it will be soon, and so it is in his memory.
Okay, now you were telling me there was another bench. Is that the bench that you're talking about?
There are two more. Two of them that you see now are sitting on pads that were these pads, these concrete pads, were in the park before. We need two pads for each bench to be able to place them on the grass so that they don't sink in. So we're waiting for the village to buy sort of like a patio block or something to sit underneath each of the legs so that they don't sink into the ground. Then the two benches will be put near each of the trees.
Yeah, this is a very beautiful high chain link fence that surrounds the park, at least on two sides, the highest part next to the river. But that adds something to it as well. Did you, was that part of your beautification project to put the fence in? Or?
Actually, that's the only good thing that came out of the flood, because there was a very old chain link fence here.
Uh-huh.
And because it was partially destroyed during the flood, we were able through, and I don't know what means, we were given a new fence. So that didn't come out of our budget at all.
Never mind, it's here. Maybe so I'll find out and bring them behind my place where the trees knocked my fence down flat.
They put the new one in and it really looks good, yes.
Will there be people available on July 18th for our viewers that might come from far away, for example, from Essex and Franklin County, and even other viewers from Clinton County? Will there be people with expertise in the history of Champlain to talk to and ask questions of on that day?
Actually, I haven't thought of that, but we'll look into that and probably, I know Celine will be down here and Missy will be, so those are two people. Maybe we can have some sort of, maybe the village historian or someone can also be here. And we can place
idea.
Them at the booth where you buy your stamps and the cancellation, maybe to ask questions.
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
I'm one of those curious people, as I said before, and I wanted to know what was here before the park was here. Calvin filled me in. But there might be people with questions that the average John Q. citizen couldn't answer, and that would be kind of neat, wouldn't it?
It would be. So anyone out there who wants to volunteer and be that, call me. Because it would be a wonderful idea.
I wouldn't be surprised if there are some family names, people that are still live in the Champlain region who were among the founding fathers here. I'm not positive of that fact, but I bet you if you went back and searched some of the names, you would see that some of those families have remained here.
I think you're going to find many of them. There's not too much migration out of the town. I mean, there's always one or two that stay. They had big families, so at least one or two people from each family has stayed in the area, even though some may have moved away. But the town is pretty much intact, I think. I found that more so than from where I came from. Everyone moved away.
That's interesting.
<myself.
laughs> Well, do you ever get back to the island?
Oh, yeah, I get back maybe four or five times a year. My parents still live there, so...
I don't have to enjoy driving on the Long Island Expressway, though, do I?
No. When I hit the city, I don't drive it. My husband does.
Aha!
But it's still nice to go home, yes.
It's always nice to go home. But you have to admit that this is now your home.
Oh, yes.
And since you've spent all of that time here, there are a lot worse places to live than Champlain, New York, I'll tell you that.
Oh, I think so. Very much so. I think that my children have had a much better life than they ever could have had on Long Island. Not that I want to disparage Long Island, but their sense of right and wrong is truly sharper than anyone else that I know that raises kids down there. So I'm grateful that we did come to live here.
You know, sometimes we fail to realize the goodness we have in our own bailiwick. And it's, you can get nearsighted and farsighted depending on your perspective and where you live. And sometimes Calvin and I have talked to this about this privately as we in the car driving toward places, about religious faith, about our school systems, about the charm of North Country politics, about the great natural beauty, and about the history that we've been talking about in our program today. Sometimes we fail to realize what we have right around us. And when we tried to save the airbase a few years ago, we talked about that phrase, quality of life. And I think you have just described it in a nutshell.
Well, thank you.
You didn't know you could do
name.
That, did you?
No, I guess that's just what I deep down
feel. But it's your personal
mm-hmm.
view of things. And there are hundreds and thousands of people who chose to raise their families in this area who would concur with exactly what you said.
Oh, yeah. I think small town life is wonderful. My children also had the advantage of being able to go to Long Island and go to the city, which I'm grateful for that as well. So some don't have that, but we have Montreal so close that, you know, there's no reason why they can't be exposed to big city life and museums and shows. It's right there.
How many times have we said we have the best of all worlds? This, you know, Clinton County is the hub. Rather than being in that far off place that maybe you thought when you were growing up on Long Island about Plattsburgh, New York and Champlain and Clinton County.
I've heard of it.
No, isn't that where the Eskimos live? And, you know.
I think everyone thinks it's the, it's very cold. They don't realize that it's not that bad. They always ask me, you know, how do you exist up there? And I say, just like everybody else, you know, just like you do. It's just a wee bit colder.
Yeah, but not all the time year. And thanks to global warming, we've had a couple of pretty good winters.
That's the scary part, yeah.
But you couldn't have chosen a better day. If July 18th is two-thirds as good as this day, and we're standing here on the, what the heck day is this, the 11th? The 11th of June, 1998, you'll be grateful.
Oh, I will be grateful for a day just like this.
You'll have to tell the village clergy to get working on that ahead of time.
I will. We will.
We do have some nice churches in this area, and some of them are rather historical, too.
Well, they're St. Mary's is a beautiful church, absolutely beautiful. I haven't been in too many of the others. In Plattsburgh, there's St. John's is a gorgeous church, and St. Peter's, now that they've renovated, is absolutely gorgeous. So the people back then took pride in their church, and that was where... That was the most important part of their life, other than their family, was the church. And they put their monies, so to speak, and everything into the church. So that's why we have nice churches.
We have some amazing edifices. And when you study it, you realize that some of the smaller community churches have changed locations. Some of them one, two, or three times over the years. Some of them have been turned into carpet stores and furniture stores, and I've even seen a few across the North Country, not to point any fingers, that have turned into bar rooms. I'm sure the original founding fathers wouldn't like that idea very much, but most of the churches here in Clinton County have remained churches. I know of one in our community of Morrisonville that's now has several apartments in it, but it's still charming to drive by it. It still looks like a church. Mm-hmm. But the churches in this community and the ones you've mentioned in Plattsburgh go back to the very earliest history. And I guess we tend to cherish our history here, not only in America, but here in northern New York, because, it, for example, in this community, it only goes back 125 years. And I say that because if people are to visit some of the wonderful churches in Europe, for example, mm-hmm. and they're talking about the year 800 and 900 and 1300.
I've seen that, and you don't know what old is until you go to Europe. We're such an infant country, you don't realize that, but it's true.
But we have so much to be proud of, and I know you are obviously very, very proud of this community. And I might say before we end this segment of our interview, that this community should be happy you moved here when you did.
Well, thank you.
You've added a great deal, and I'm sure it's been enriching for you, too.
Oh, it has been. I enjoy doing it.
I can't wait to come back on July 18th. Mary Ann, thanks so much.
Well, you're welcome. And do come.
Mary Ann Kerr, who is not only has worked at the post office for a long time, but is the chairperson of this beautification committee that's responsible for what you see here. And you ain't seen nothing yet. Big plans for July 18th. Our program continues in just a few moments. As we said when we began our program today, living in the village or the community, the town of Champlain is a unique experience. And Calvin points out that that's for many, many reasons. The incorporation came in 1873. And how many other villages of Champlain do you think there are in the world, or towns of Champlain? Melissa McManus, how are you?
Fine, thank you.
Missy,
thank you.
If you don't mind.
That's fine, that's what everyone calls me. That's
the mayor of this thriving metropolis.
Mm-hmm.
There aren't very many Champlains around. There are lots of things called Champlain.
Right.
But no other villages that I know of.
Not that I'm aware of, no. Not that I've ever heard.
See, we had a dude that came down through here some years back who mm-hmm. has reputedly saw the Lake Champlain monster. And his name was Samuel de Champlain, and this huge, great lake that's not too far from where we're sitting in the village offices,
right,
was named after him. Mm-hmm. And Calvin and I have traveled around the country, and there are lots of things named Champlain, mm-hmm. mountains and malls, and
right.
So they'd like to capitalize on it, but we've got it.
We do.
We've got the original Champlain.
As a matter of fact, we have Samuel over on Church Street. You can go, and I don't know if you've seen the monument.
Yes, I have. Maybe we'll get a chance to get a view of it either today or during the walking tour on July 18th.
Very good. Very good.
It's taken a long time for you and I to meet.
It has. It really has.
That's ridiculous.
I've heard your voice for years and years. The blizzard in particular. I remember listening.
You were only about 2 years old. What year was that?
93. Oh, no.
Oh.
No, I was on the board.
Were you really?
Yeah, I was on the village board then. Yeah.
Well, let's...
We met, I think, the Monday or Tuesday and worked on the budget while everything was shut down. So.
We've had our share of problems.
We have, but we take them in stride.
And you know, we talked about that earlier with Mary Ann, how the people work together.
Mm-hmm.
In communities this size, it's mm-hmm. amazing.
It is. It's wonderful. The resiliency. I was thinking the other day about River Street and the first flood when I was on the board. I went down and I felt so bad, and I was saying to people, oh, I'm so sorry. And they were like, it's okay, Melissa, really? This happens, don't. They were consoling me because I felt badly about it. And it's just a tremendous spirit here. There really is.
A bunch of survivors. I've noticed that from the very beginning. No matter what kind of flood or pestilence comes through the area, they get together and they manage to knuckle through, and it makes the family stronger.
Oh, absolutely.
It makes the community stronger.
Right.
And it gives us something to talk about in the course of our 125th anniversary.
Right.
Before we start talking about the history of this community,
mm-hmm.
I want to talk about your personal history, because you were born and brought up in this northern tier.
Certainly was.
Tell me about it.
I'm from Rouse's Point originally. My mom's family's been here for years and years. My dad's family's from Ogdensburg. And went to school at Northeastern Clinton, got my degree from Plattsburgh State, actually both my teaching degrees from Plattsburgh. And except for a couple years of school in Boston, I've been here all my life.
Let's mention some of those family names so that people will know.
Well, my mom is Terry Penfield, and I have to thank her because she's taking care of my baby right now, so I can be
good.
Here.
That's
my dad is Raymond. They live on Pratt Street in Rouse's Point. And my aunt and uncle are pretty well known in the town, Ruth and Leo Letourneau. Grew up right down the street from them, so I have pretty deep roots here, definitely. And then I made the incredible decision of moving all the way from Rouse's Point to Champlain. Huge westward trek my husband and I took, 12 years ago now. We've been in the village for 12 years. So I didn't get very far, but I'm pretty happy
home.
With where
it
I am. That's
is.
Right.
We should tell people that you decided early on that you wanted to go into the teaching profession, and so you did.
I did. I've taught for 13 years, American history for all 13 years, and then economics for several years in Beekman Town. Yep. And I'm on maternity leave right now for this year and next year at least, and we'll see past that.
But when did the political aspirations start to develop?
I think I was just bred to. Absolutely. One of my earliest memories is running around stuffing flyers for my uncle in people's mailboxes, which I know you're not supposed to do now, but we used to go and flip them in the slots in the door for my Uncle Leo. And my mom was the village clerk over in Rouse's Point. And there just always was that tradition of involvement in local government. So, I guess I'm unusual in that I grew up thinking that politicians were good people who helped out the community. I know they don't have that reputation today, but that was the way I was.
Well,
I was
you're here to enhance the reputation.
Well,
not embellish it, but enhance the reputation. And it's a way to give back.
Absolutely.
It's not like big city politics. We talked about the charm. I use the word charm of North Country politics because it fascinated me right from the very beginning. When I came here in 1961 and started to work in the radio business, one of my first official duties was to cover the elections.
I came
to work in October and covered the elections in November.
Mm-hmm.
And in that time, the senior citizen women were still counting ballots at an old school house down on Skamotion Creek that Calvin's not old enough to remember, and I know you are. But they were counting paper ballots and arguing.
Mm.
And then my job that night was to get the number of ballots on the radio before anything happened. All of a sudden, I turned around, and after a major argument among these people of different parties who were counting the ballots, they all put the ballots in a box and went home. And I was standing there with a microphone, no idea what the argument was all about.
Isn't that so?
I almost ended my radio career before it began. But that's where the charm is.
Well, you would love Champlain, because here in the village, we don't have political parties. We have a Citizens Union Caucus that meets in February and endorses candidates, and then if other people want to run, they run independently. And so there's no party politics here in the village, and it's wonderful. It's just a wonderful
place. How many mayors have there been here?
Oh, good heavens.
Do you have any clue?
We have, actually. Joanne,
just happened to have that right here.
Deputy clerk has put together a list. We updated the mayor since the centennial. I have that in here. Oh, here we go. This is the original list that Larry Paquette did, I think with Woody McClellan at the 73 centennial. So that is through 73, and here's the update.
I'm sure there are names on there which are familiar. When
Absolutely.
Calvin and I were talking with Marianne, we were trying to determine how many families might go back to the very beginning of the incorporation, and there are families that do.
Name Southwick. I'm trying to think of other names I've seen in the history. I'm sure there are. Well, the Moore family.
Ashline.
That's the update since
Ashline. He
Ashline.
Mentioned the Ashline family, another
right.
long-term family.
Right. It'd be interesting to take the map that I used to do my walking tour and actually count and highlight the people who are still here.
That's kind of neat, because it's a tight-knit community, and although there have been a number of people who've moved here over the years, a lot of those same families have stayed here.
Absolutely.
For very good reasons. It's a darn good place.
I bet it is. It
is. So how long have you been mayor?
I've been mayor for a little over a year. I took over in April last year. I'd been on the board for 5 years before that, so been on here working here in the village for about 6 years.
Does that take up a lot of your time?
Yes. I can
say that. Day and night, 20 hours a day.
In fact, when I was teaching, sometimes it was hard to figure out which one I was putting more work into, because we've had some real challenges to deal with, you know, water and sewer problems. The budget is always a challenge, and so it takes a lot of time, but it's a labor of love. I mean, I do enjoy it tremendously, and it's
notice
very
she
satisfying.
Took a deep breath when she said that. A deep
is.
Breath and a sigh. It's a labor of love.
It is.
Just
it
keep
is.
Telling yourself
no,
that.
No, it really is. There's no doubt about it.
Yes, you have had challenges.
Absolutely.
Almost as many challenges in your brief tenure as this whole list of people had in
well,
their entire lifetime.
I know. I think I was fortunate in that. The tough days were right when Harris closed. I think those years, the 86 through the mid-90s, were the really tough times. I think I've been fortunate to be able to see some progress that people had worked on for years that is now coming to fruition. Like, we paved Church Street last year, and that was as a result of work, you know, that had been done by many people, village, town, for years. We were able to get the money to do that. So it's nice to be able to see the progress happening.
Sometimes it's much slower than you'd like to see.
That is one lesson that absolutely. You triple the amount of time you think it'll take, and then it still takes longer. But it
sometimes
it eventually
triple
happens.
The amount you planned on in the beginning.
Well, that unfortunately can be true too.
Definitely. Well, we're going to talk a lot about the history of this area before mm-hmm. we're through, because that was our main purpose of coming here today. But before we do that, let's talk about the future. There are some nice things happening.
There are some wonderful things happening. I'm so glad that you asked me that, because we had, I don't know if you know, we had some publicity a few weeks ago where we actually had a broadcast from Paquette Park. And that tended to focus a lot on the flooding and the ice storm and everything, and which certainly is, it's an excellent story, but I'm glad to be able to talk about what's happening that's going to be good for the future of Champlain. Where to start? We have, you know, what has, I was talking to Shan Moore, who's the Press Republican.
Oh, yes.
She came and, you probably saw the article, interviewed us. And what brought people to Champlain originally was the Great Chazy River. I mean, I've never read that where Pliny Moore said that's why he came, but I'm pretty sure because the river narrows up behind Coulomb's store, out where Mill Street is. I'm pretty sure that's why they located here. So what brought people here and what provided for the early prosperity has proven to be a difficulty in the past 100 years where the river has flooded over and over again. And what we've been able to do as a result of the disaster area declaration in November of 96, we've been able to get FEMA funding to hopefully prevent some of that flooding. And so right now we have a $177,000 grant to do ice control in the Great Chazy. We're talking about putting in concrete or granite blocks in the river that will form an artificial ice jam, allow the river then to flood up on our property around and run around it, so we don't have the flooding in our downtown.
Wow.
So I mean, that in itself is huge. That would, yeah. You go. I'm sure since you've been, how many floods did you cover? Like, probably a lot.
Well, you know, and also behind my house, because I live 18 inches from the Saranac River in Morrisonville.
So
I know what you're going through, and we. You know, what I go through is a microcosm of what happens up here.
Right, and closely related to that is the buyout of people's homes on River Street. River Street, true to its name, is located very close to the river. It's basically right at the same elevation. And so it's flooded a lot recently. And because, of that disaster area declaration in 96, the federal government is offering a buyout to the people on River Street so they can receive the assessed, well, hopefully close to the assessed value of their home in cash and move to higher ground. And so that is, you know, we're very glad that people will have that opportunity, because people tell me, I've heard a lot of different theories as to the flooding, you know, larger culvert sizes are causing the runoff to be faster and more development, the water runs off faster. I don't know, but certainly it's been more and more of a problem in recent years. So it would be nice if those people had the chance to get out while the money's there, because chances are we won't see another disaster declaration. We won't see another disaster declaration for flooding in the village.
Well,
so that's just the river.
That's great.
Okay.
Next?
Next. Well, we have some economic development taking place that hopefully will slowly start to make up for what we lost when Harris closed. This village was hit extremely hard, both in terms of jobs and income for the residents and the assessed value that we have to tax on. So, you know, our tax rate is higher than I'd like it to be, largely because we lost about a third of our assessed value when Harris pulled out of town. And so we have a new industrial park that is on the eastern end of the village. You've probably seen the Molson USA warehouse. There's a new building that just went in within the past year and a half. It was a building built by the county as a spec building. The Area Development Corporation put that up. They are selling it to a company called Eastern Diecast. They work with aluminum ingots. I haven't been over to see, but I know they do some processing of that and a lot of good jobs over there. So we're very pleased about that. There's construction going on behind those buildings. That entire area is being opened up for an industrial park. And so right now the county is working with another EDA grant to build the road, water and sewer, all the infrastructure that's needed to develop that land. So that's good news for us.
Hey, you're doing very well. Major things
happening
up here.
Major things, definitely.
So you do have some good plans for the future. You have a special dedication that's going to take place on July 18th.
We do. The 125th anniversary and the dedication of Paquette Park downtown. It's going to be really fun.
I want to pick up a couple of these photographs.
Sure.
Because as we were standing by the park with Marianne, looking at that dreaded tree that ended up under the bridge and almost caused us no end of grief.
Right.
We could see not this bridge, because it's been replaced, but the building in the background, which people should easily remember. And this is from your private collection, I have no idea what how far back the postcard would go.
I think that one's the 19... Oh, I can't... Maybe 1908. It's hard to read the postmark, but it's certainly the probably the first decade in the 1900s.
Somebody... That was no doubt not a color photograph. Somebody tinted those postcards.
I think so.
It's interesting to note that these postcards, most of them were printed not here, but in Germany. Mm. Here's another one. What would this scene be, Miss?
Let me just take a quick peek. Oh, that's looking in the other direction on the bridge, looking down into the downtown, the Champlain House in the background and both sides of the bridge.
Are some of those buildings still exist?
Absolutely. I'm going to show you some slides of them.
Oh, yeah. Wonderful. And here's another one. These are just to, these are just to whet our appetites.
That's wonderful. That's one of the photo cards. And I'd like someone to help me figure out what year that is because it wasn't postmarked. I'm guessing late 40s from the cars, but I'm no expert in that area. So
I would say if you needed my guess, depending on whether the how many of these cars were new, because there are cars that date back to the early 20s,
right.
But there are some that also date to about 1935.
So maybe the 30s.
So let's say 1935, 1936. Very possible. And it's also possible some of our viewers might have been there when picture was taken.
Absolutely.
And that's the beauty of doing a program like this.
Right. That actually, I should take the opportunity to thank the people that helped me put this together. Tony and Eleanor Fillion, who live out on Elm Street. Tony was around back then, and Eleanor too. And they gave me a lot of information in putting this all together.
We talked with Marianne, and we wondered if there was going to be anybody who was well versed in the history of the community who would be around on July 18th. You are. But you have a village historian, don't
we do,
you?
We do, Mrs. Bayshard, and she is putting together a compilation of various sources on Champlain that she will be offering that day. Mm-hmm. She's taken things from the county history and various articles that were published, and we'll have it available for people who might want to pick that up and do some more in-depth, because it's hard to cover the whole history in just a short period of time, so that'll be available that day.
Actually, there are several resources for old photographs of this area, and you're going to tap at least two of them that I know of.
Yes, yes. The other person who was very, very, very instrumental in putting this all together was of course, Bob Venn. And I can still, one of the most fun things I've done for history, Bob called me to take a look at a photo, and he was trying to figure out what year it was. And it was the old Victorian storefront that is located, would be down past the Masonic, what we call the Masonic building now. And we were looking at it, and there was this huge banner in front, and it had Grant and Wilson. And at first we were thinking, was that the name of the store? And then I said, Bob, I bet that's the election, either 1868 or 1872. And sure enough, we looked it up, and Wilson was Grant's vice presidential candidate. And it was just so exciting to see that. This village, while it's gotten, I think, less political, they were very, very involved in Democrat-Republican politics. They used to hold torchlight parades. I'm reading some of the diaries of people doing that when Lincoln was elected and so on. It's really interesting.
So it's a real fun thing for you, passion to get into the history.
When Calvin called, I was thinking, I have so much I have to do. But then it's given me a chance to dust off some of my historical work, because that's where I started. I was the town historian for a couple of years. And of course, that's my job was history, and it's been so much fun. I had forgotten a lot of the things I want to tell you today, and it was just fun. That was an interesting detail. But anyway, back to the photographs, because I know you wanted. The other place that local residents can go for photographs is at the Feinberg Library at Plattsburgh State. Down in the basement, there's a place called Special Collections, and Woody and Hulda McClellan, who were the historians in the area. I mean, you name it, they had it. They had everything we have. What I'm drawing from basically goes back to them. They donated their collection to the library, and I think that caused. I think some people would have rather had it stay here in the town, but they're really well set up to preserve it, and it's indexed and it's cataloged. So if people wanted to go look at old photographs of Champlain, there are albums, that thick of everything except a photo of my house. My husband and I spent I don't know how much time looking, and there were a lot of them where they stood on our lawn and took a picture of Doc Wooten's house, but they never turned around and took. Actually, we found a couple of shots, but not anything like some of the other homes or photographs.
Now, what time period would those pictures have been taken?
Oh, they could be anywhere from, you know, 1860s, 70s, right up on through, because they collected. In addition, they documented, the McClellans documented a lot of history, but they also collected. So they would grab hold of any, kind of like Bob ended up doing, and anything that he thought would have historical importance was picked up. So there's a huge variety. A lot of the streets aren't paved. You can still see the old iron fences that disappeared during World War I when they melted them all down. It's fascinating to go take a look. So I really encourage people who have an interest to go down and do that.
So for the purposes of this celebration, we're going back to the incorporation in 1873.
Right.
But this community existed before that.
Oh, absolutely. The community was 85 years old when the village was officially incorporated, by a very close vote, by the way. It was not at all unanimous. Oh, I knew four votes. It was like 91 to 87. And then the next year, they filed a petition to disincorporate, and that went down by about 20 votes. So it was touch and go for a while as to whether there was actually going to be a village here. But yeah, Pliny Moore and his compatriots settled here in 1788. And so there's a long history of settlement. Actually, that's a real Yankee view of history. There was French-Canadian settlement in this area before that because the English settlers wrote the history, doesn't quite get counted. That's another thing about Champlain, the French village, and if you look at the names, the ethnic area where the French families were up in one area, there's so much that you can find here. The Bible burnings, and the real looking down on Catholicism by the Yankee Protestants. There was a lot that went on in this village. I mean, I could show people church records that they wouldn't believe. It's very fascinating to me.
It's a great study. You could spend your lifetime getting into those minutiae.
Oh,
yeah.
You could. And what happened? I'm no expert in local history, but I work in a summer program where we teach local history to kids, and that was how I ended up at Special Collections. And there's this huge row of boxes, and unusual for a library. It was just kind of sitting there, and I had to do some work for my master's degree. I had to do some research, and I started going through, and I realized it was all Champlain. And so for the next, I don't know how many Saturdays, I was down there digging through all these dusty boxes, reading people's diaries, and that's where all this comes from.
Does it? Are you? I was mentioning standing on the riverbank a while ago about being transported back in time, closing my eyes and imagining what this street looked like.
Absolutely.
125 years ago.
Absolutely.
When you open people's diaries, you are instantly transported into the whatever they were feeling.
You are, and it's what I think is amazing is how like. I mean, they're like us. I mean, they're people, and they have the same concerns and the same hopes. And a lot of the women's diaries that I read were the Moore and then the Nye family diaries. And they were very wealthy young ladies. I mean, they were doing things that the average Champlain girl wasn't going to be doing, like taking a grand tour of Europe. But wondering about a husband, and were they too picky in terms of appearance? Mother says, I worry too much about the surface. You know, you're thinking, I taught 13 and 14-year-olds, and I would say, you know, what do you guys worry about? Well, it hasn't changed very much from back then.
Really fascinating. Well, we're going to do some more history.
Okay.
We're going to look around this room. Before we pause for a moment, I want to look up on this wall. Mm. There may be some glare there.
Why don't I turn the light off for you?
Just to check that picture and see if you can see it better without.
Is that better, Callie?
Now, tell us what that is. Get over here next to the microphone and tell us what that is.
That is, we're assuming that is the map that was done when the village was incorporated in 1873. It says a map of Champlain Village, and it's dated 1873. And so we found that in the safe, had it repaired and matted and framed to protect it so that we wouldn't, you can see at the top it's had a little bit of wear, but we tried to preserve it for as a really important artifact for the village.
It was probably all folded up or rolled up.
Rolled.
Rolled.
Actually, again, Joanne, my my secretary deputy clerk said, you know, you might want to take a look at this, and handed me that one and that one also.
She's terrific, because I know one of her counterparts, Keith Herklow, who's the clerk down in,
oh,
the,
yes,
in the city of Plattsburgh, has been such a digger. He has found things on the back of pictures, inside photographs, pages of old village minutes,
right,
at a home, at somebody's home down south. The guy is amazing. And so it's so much fun to recognize when you find a little piece of history and to,
absolutely,
fit it in its place in the puzzle.
Yeah, we're hoping to get some more funding. We've been gone through the SARA program, where the State Archives actually gives you money to preserve your records. And we've gone through several levels of that, and hopefully we can get another grant to look for the maps and make sure the maps are preserved appropriately. This one is very interesting. This puzzles me. I'm not sure what this is. I'm not sure how accurate it is. It's dated, I think, 1842. And it says a map of the village of Champlain. It's all laid out in plots. I think it was someone's plan for the village. If you look at the street names, they're quite different from even what they ended up being called. It's one of those little puzzlements of history that we're left with, but certainly an interesting artifact. One of the things that happened when the village was incorporated is a lot of the street names were changed. They went from...
Shades of 911.
Well, yes, there must have been a real back to nature movement at that time, because a lot of the names went to tree names. For example...
As they did in almost every community in America.
Canada Street became Oak Street. And Second Street, you can see on the map, became Cedar Street. And that was, you can really see the changes from that map to the actual 1873 map.
I think every village in America has an Oak Street and an Elm Street.
I think so. Right. It gets confusing for people when you try to give them directions. Oak and maple and butternut and elm. It's just too many trees.
We're going to take a little breather and continue our wonderful historic walking tour right in this room. The village of Champlain, in celebration of its 125th anniversary, in just a few moments. Well, if you're a history teacher, you always have to have a slideshow or an overhead or some means of projecting things on the wall. And if you could see what we went through to get this picture straight today before we started, we finally got the right thickness of name tags underneath the projector. Missy, what are you going to show us today, and what's this first picture all about?
Well, this first picture is what is currently the KFC building here in Champlain. Back in 1873, it would have been referred to as the Session House. It has a very interesting history. It was constructed as a temporary church for the Presbyterian Church. And the story that leads up to it is unbelievable. The actual church was located farther up Oak Street. An arsonist who was planning on burning down the courthouse in Montreal supposedly burned down the Presbyterian Church here in Champlain as practice. And they that's the story. And they constructed this building as a temporary church before they built their main church, which I'll be showing you, the old village hall on Main Street. The churches in Champlain, it was musical chairs. It's almost impossible to sort out the movements between the Presbyterians, the Methodists, the Catholics. They frequently switch properties. But that's how this building started. It's, to me, a particularly appropriate place to start because Woody McClellan ran the Mooresfield Press out of that building.
Oh,
and
wow.
So
that
was
sense.
Right. And it is a brick building. It has the roof line that actually the triangle faces out on the street, the old Greek Revival style. There's brick underneath there. It did have at one time a round window facing out to the front. And it's been, that's a some sort of siding, I believe, that was put on by the KFC. It's housed, just you name it, it's been in the building. A jail, fire station, numerous stores. I guess people probably remember it best. The old Lyceum Theater was there.
Oh, my goodness, is that where it was?
Yeah, between 1918 and 1948.
Famous place.
Yeah, I guess a lot of the village residents remember the night the film caught fire and almost exploded. They almost lost the building in a fire. So it's had an interesting history.
Now, are these buildings going to be part of your walking tour?
Yes. We'll start right here.
Okay.
And, well, actually...
Move along whenever you're ready.
Okay. We've moved just across the street. We're facing, looking across Elm Street at what was the Pliny Moore home. This building was built in 1800 and 1801 by Pliny Moore. Cost him $2,000 to build, if you can believe that, including two barrels of rum that apparently he passed out for people helping him. It housed the first piano in town. Pliny Moore bought a harpsichord for his daughters. During the War of 1812, it was headquarters for the British soldiers because we had some visitors here in Champlain in 1814 for 3 weeks. The British honored us with their presence, and the officers were at Pliny Moore's. Later, the house passed to the McClellan family. They were descendants of Pliny Moore. Now, what you're seeing is actually a reconstruction of the house. The original burned in 1912. There was a bad fire that started across from the village hall on Main Street. Apparently, there was a huge wind they described as almost of tornado proportions that blew the fire across the river, and this house caught fire and burned to the ground. The McClellans, Woody was the historian, Hugh was an architect, and he had detailed plans. And there are pictures of the rebuilding of this house in 1912. So,
great.
Okay. Moving on farther down Elm Street, what you're seeing is the Friend home today. If you had been walking around in 1873, you would have been looking at a three-story building called the Champlain Academy. It was the private high school, one of only four in the county at that time. And it was built in 1842. It was the $5,000 it cost to build that building was raised by private subscriptions. A lot of controversy because people thought it was too far out of town. At this time, most of the development was on the other side of the river, and so they thought that it was impractical. That building burned and was replaced by the new academy, which was part of the Champlain school system until it burned down in 1940. And there are a lot of people out there who went to school in that building. And I will have a picture, actually several pictures of the two buildings when I do the actual walking tour. Dr. Southwick apparently lost his mittens. He'd gotten new mittens, and they were in the building, and they burned up, and he's never forgotten that his mittens went with the building. So that's the site of the Champlain Academy. As we go further to the east, on Elm Street, this building was known as Locust Hill, and it was by far the grandest home in Champlain in 1873. It was built by Freeman Nye, who was a business partner of the Moores, married one of Pliny Moore's granddaughters, and it was called Locust Hill. There were locust trees all actually stretching up Elm Street. There's still a lot of them on the other side of the road. Ornamental gardens that stretched out to the east of the house. There was a circular driveway for carriages to come in and out. Really a beautiful building with all of the outbuildings and the gardens and so on. And this building was passed on to Nellie Nye, who lived until the 1820s. So I'm sure there are people that would remember her. And later,
1920s, you mean?
Right. 1920s, right. I think she died in 1922, so I know there are people. Did I say 1820s? Nobody around would remember her. Sorry. and of course, this building that's owned by Red DeMars now, people my age knew it as a much different place. The Savoy was the local watering hole for people a lot of the teenagers, when we were graduated from high school, we spent a lot of time there that summer. And I've always laughed because if those women had ever known the amount of drinking that was going to take place, if they were all WCTU, all strong temperance people, they must have been turning over in their graves. But that's another story. Okay, we're going to turn around now and move back down into town. This is just a view going down. The building I'm going to talk about next is in the background, and that is the First National Bank of Champlain. and there's a better view of it. This building wasn't here in 1873. In 1873, there was a doctor's office located there, but very soon afterward, in 1880, I believe, this building was constructed. And it started off, unbelievably, as just the first floor. It must have looked so different with just the stone building. And then in 1901, they added the second story and the roof as it is now. Now that, I don't know if we want to take another look at the postcard, because you can get a nice view of the bank about 1900 and the old bridge on Elm Street. It's probably hard to see on the camera, but there was a really intricately carved wooden canopy over the front entrance. And the First National Bank of Champlain, unfortunately, did not survive the Great Depression. Crashed during the Depression. A lot of the founding families lost a lot of money in the crash. Later on, I believe it was Plattsburgh National Bank moved in, and then National Commercial, which became Key Bank. They had their offices there. It also housed the offices for the Champlain Creamery, and the library at one time was run out of this building. Okay, now we're gonna look across the bridge. My apologies for the quality of the slide. The large building that you see in the background, the Champlain House, and that's it on a sunny morning a couple of Januaries ago. The Champlain House was built, so I understand, as a place for some of the wealthier Champlainers' guests to stay and to eat. It was constructed in 1850, and supposedly if you could get here, you could get a fantastic meal for 50 cents at the Champlain House.
Where do I line up?
By 1873, it was very well known, advertised throughout the area. There was a carriage with Champlain House engraved on the side that would pick you up either at the steamer dock in Rouse's Point or at the depot, in the railroad depot in Champlain, and deliver you to the Champlain House where people came to vacation. I think they had one of the first telephones in the village. The telephone was installed in 1898 in the Champlain House. And we also have a postcard. It's difficult. It's a little dark in the background. I don't know if you want to
hold
that
it
up. You can see that the building at one time had a second floor balcony. Maybe I can just point that out right along there. And a widow's walk up on the roof, which unfortunately I guess were lost in subsequent reconstructions. And this is another building that has since had a much more colorful history than its days at the Champlain House. Okay, and now we're going to take a right turn on Main Street, head down to the Old Village Hall, which in 1873 was the Presbyterian Congregational Church. This was the one that was built to replace the one that the arsonist burned down. It had an 800-pound bell and a pipe organ that cost $800, which back then was a lot of money. It also had an interesting steeple that I have never seen, and I'm going to try to get a picture of this. It was an octagonal steeple, flat on the top, supported by pillars. Unfortunately, that was lost in recent years too. This building burned on the inside in 1927 and was redone as the Village Hall. And you can actually read that on the building still on the front. It was the Village of Champlain Hall from 1929 until, I believe, the centennial year. I think it was in 1973 that the village moved up here to Main Street. During the Depression, this was a very, very important place in the community. It apparently they held exhibitions where they would bring in farm and business exhibits, try to get the community together from 1930 to 1936, and pack the place, I guess, on Saturday nights. They also held wrestling matches and basketball games right there. Boxing, right. Oral, I guess. There are some old posters from the Mooresfield Press of some of those boxing matches. That would maybe I can try to get a hold of one of those for the tour too. In front of this building, there's a monument on a little boulder that's down there for the actual 150th anniversary of Champlain's discovery of the lake. To the early settlers. It's the 150th anniversary of Plenty More coming. And so this building is now industrial knitting, and the village has relocated to our where we are right here on Main Street. And then heading back to the west, this building was known as the Nye Block. It was owned by Freeman Nye's, the people who inherited his estate. It's two storefronts that are attached by that center block. Also some interesting history here. The left part of the building, the upstairs was known as Champlain Hall. And it was a kind of an assembly hall where they would bring in lecturers and hold assemblies. A great favorite were the traveling lecturers who would talk about the evils of demon rum and about temperance and tell stories about people who came out of the bar, got drunk, and froze to death after they fell off their horse. There are a lot of those written in the records. Downstairs, there were a couple of stores, F.L. Chan.
I thought you were going to say there are a couple of bar rooms downstairs.
No, not that.
Okay.
There was a dry goods dealer and a grocer downstairs. And it would be nice to be able to get a picture of that. I'm sure that it's in existence that would show the FL Channel and the Channel and Smith that were down there at that point. Now, the postcard that we have shows the building, and Gordy tells me now we should probably be thinking late 30s, when the Grand Union and the A&P were in those locations. That's a great old photograph. The Texaco, I'm not sure, some sort of a post in the middle of the street apparently directs people to Montreal, because that bridge was the main, it took you up Oak Street, which was at that point the main route up to Montreal. And speaking of bar rooms, the Meridian out on Oak Street was brought a lot of traffic through the village at that point. And so basically that's just a preview of some of the locations we'll be looking at in our walking tour. On July 18th.
All right, we'll continue our wonderful program in just a moment. We've seen that picture before today, as we were shown what the beautiful cancellation will be on that day in the post office. That's kind of a unique event all by itself. But this picture is on the front of our brochure, The Village of Champlain 125th Anniversary Celebration. And tell us what some of the things that'll be happening that day.
Okay. Well, we this whole celebration has grown out of what started off as the dedication of Paquette Park and the 125th anniversary. And we have a group of residents. You met with Marianne Kerr, who have really spearheaded the whole thing. This has not come from the village board. This has come from our beautification committee, our rec committee, and so on. And we're going to start off with dedication of our new wastewater treatment plant.
I should mention, people wonder what that distraction was. We're sitting here right in the middle of the village offices, and people come in and out.
Right.
It's the beauty of hometown cable.
It is. We're a little limited for space in the village, unfortunately.
We don't stop the cameras unless you hear gunshots. And that would only be because Calvin dropped the camera to run. All right.
Okay.
Go on.
Okay. And so we're having our dedication and our cutting and tours of our treatment plant, which I know sounds funny, but it is the most valuable asset the village has.
It doesn't sound a bit funny for those who know.
We have decided not to dedicate it to anyone because no one really said I wanted a wastewater treatment plant named after me. As you mentioned, the postal stamp cancellation will take place in the park. At 1:15, we're having the dedication of Paquette Park. And that will probably be the center of the ceremonies for the day. And then at 2 o'clock, the walking tour. During the day, there will be other events for people, village-wide garage sales. They're going to have food vendors, there will be a flea market, and clowns and face painting and balloons for the kids. So it should be a fun day.
And even Smokey Rabideau in the RSVP kitchen.
Hey,
band. They are such wonderful people. Now, tell us a little bit about the booklet.
Okay. The booklet is being coordinated by Celine Paquette. She's wanted to update what Larry and Woody McClellan had done for the centennial. And so she met with our Recreation and Beautification Committees, who have really worked on putting the anniversary together. There is going to be an update on the mayors, as we talked about, the mayors and the board members. There's a brief update on the history of the village from 73 to 98. A special feature on Bill Earle, who I'm not very familiar with, but Celine has talked a lot. He was a very important person to the young people of this community. Lived and worked down on River Street, and apparently was like the Pied Piper. A lot of the young men in the community would go down to his bicycle shop and he'd fix their bikes up, and so there's going to be a feature on him. And so it's something different. It's not just a reprint of the old 1788 and on history. It's some new things that probably have not been published before or that have not been collected in the same way. So that booklet will be available for a real modest price, a nice souvenir of the 125th. That people will be able to purchase. And my understanding is there'll be t-shirts with the village seal, which really is lovely. That's Samuel de Champlain's crest that we have as a seal. And to me, the motto really is Champlain. And I don't know the exact translation, but it's something like hard work triumphs or something like that. And
for
the people
of this
village, I think that's really neat.
It's worked for you and for the many people who've lived here over the years. And
absolutely.
I think that this community has a great deal to be proud of.
So do I.
Not the least of which is the fact that you are now its mayor, and you have such a wonderful energy and compassion and vibrance.
Thank you.
That it's bound to, I'm sure that you've imparted a lot of that among your students and their families over the years, and now in this village, and I admire you for taking on an undertaking. It's very difficult.
It's a challenging job.
Very
no
challenging.
No doubt about it. But it's there's a lot of satisfaction in being able to see progress happen, and that's nice.
And we started our program here today by talking about progress, mm-hmm. and I know things are going to do very well in the future because of the foundation that's been laid in the past.
Absolutely, and that's one thing I'd like to mention. We are going to be sending one of these to all of the living prior board members.
Isn't that a neat idea?
Because the progress is not, I mean, it's not just this board or the past board, it's all the way back, and so they'll be going out to everyone, and we hope they'll come and join us.
So, if you want to become a part of North Country history at its very best, plan to come to the village of Champlain, start early and spend the entire day. We're going to have yard sale mania here on July 18th on a Saturday. We've already looked up to the sky and told Marianne she better get a hold of the clergy to get them on their knees early so we have a day precisely like this 11th day of June.
Father said at the parade he had a system worked out. So we'll hope.
We know who to blame if it doesn't turn out. Missy, thanks so much for being with us. Thanks so much for everything you do for this North Country.
Well, thank you, and thank you very much for coming and giving us a chance to let people know about what's going on.
I hope you join us for our celebration here on July 18th, and who knows where we'll be next time for our little corner.